Hello everyone, today we are going to start the new chapter, that is environment and health, and we will be covering the sources of water and water related diseases. So what is environment? The term environment implies to all the external factors, living and non-living, material and non-material, which surround man. For descriptive purpose, environment has been divided into three components. The number one is the physical, which includes your water, air, soil, housing, waste, radiation, etc. The second one is the biological, that includes plant and animal life, including the bacteria, viruses, insect, rodents, animals. The third one is the social, which is our customs, culture, habits, income, occupation, religion, etc. The key to man's health lies largely in his environment. In fact, much of man's ill health can be traced to adverse environmental factors such as water pollution, soil pollution, air pollution, poor housing conditions, presence of animal reservoirs and insect vectors of disease, which pose a constant threat to man's health. In 1972, the UN Conference on Human Environment focused worldwide attention on the environmental hazards that threaten human beings. So we will be going through few definitions, and the one of the most important definition is sanitation. So we keep on saying sanitation, sanitation. So what is sanitation? Sanitation is the science of safeguarding the health, in simple words. Okay, but the National Sanitation Foundation of the USA says that sanitation is a way of life. The WHO uses term environmental sanitation and has been defined by WHO as the control of all those factors in man's physical environment which exercise or may exercise a deleterious effect on his physical development, health and survival. What now this environmental sanitation term is replaced by the environmental health, and the purpose of environmental health is to create and maintain ecological conditions that will promote health and thus prevent diseases. To achieve health for all, we require at least healthy environment and healthy lifestyle, and also require initiatives by the individual, the family and the community to achieve health for all. Much of the ill health in India is due to poor environmental sanitation, that is unsafe water, polluted soil, unhygienic disposal of human excreta and refuse, poor housing, insects and rodents. And now another problem which is increasing day by day is the air pollution. So water. As I said, the much of the ill health which affects humanity, especially in the developing countries, can be traced to lack of safe and wholesome water supply. So what is safe and wholesome water? The water intended for human consumption should be both safe and wholesome, and this has been defined as water that is, number one, free from pathogenic agents, free from harmful chemical substances, pleasant to the taste, usable for domestic purpose. Water is said to be polluted or contaminated when it does not fulfill the any of the above criteria. So what is the water requirement daily? For survival, around 2 liters of drinking water is required for a day, and a daily supply of 150 to 200 liters per capita is considered as adequate supply for all the domestic purposes needs. It must be available close to the people, else they have to spend hours and lot of energy going back and forth to obtain it, and the water is often polluted in this process. So what are the uses of water? The uses of water include, number one is the domestic use. On domestic front, we require water for drinking, cooking, washing, bathing, flushing of toilets, gardening, etc. On second is the public purpose, where we require for cleaning the streets, recreational purpose like swimming pools, public fountains, ornamental ponds, fire protection, and in public parks. Industrial purposes, the processing and the culling require the water. Agriculture purpose, irrigation mainly. The fifth one is the power production from hydropower and steam power. Sixth one is for carrying away waste from all manner of establishments and institution. So, keeping in this mind, the water is therefore an essential factor in the economic, social and cultural development of a community and finally for a nation. So, from where we get the water, the sources of water? So, we all know, have you read in your previous classes in school, that water is obtained from the hydrological cycle. And the safe yield of the source from where you are getting the water must be sufficient to serve the population expected at the end of the design period, around, you can say, around 10 to 50 years in the future. The safe yield is generally defined as the yield that is adequate for 95% of the year. The selection of the source requires professional advice, because you cannot draw water from anywhere, everywhere where you like. In general, water sources must conform two criteria. Number one, the quantity must be sufficient to meet present and future requirement. The second is the quality of the water must be acceptable as per the standards. So there are three main sources of water. We can see the rain. The second one is the surface water, which includes impounding reservoirs, rivers and streams, tanks, ponds and lakes. The third one is the groundwater, the shallow wells, the deep wells, and the springs. So we will be covering one by one. The first one is the rain. The rain is the prime source of all water. So a part of the rainwater sinks into the ground to form the groundwater. Part of it evaporates back into the atmosphere, and some run off to the streams and rivers, which flow ultimately into the sea, and from sea again by evaporation. So these cycles keep on. So what are the characters of the rainwater? The rainwater is purest water in nature. Physically it is clear, bright and sparkling. Chemically it is very soft water, containing only traces of dissolved solids like 0.0005%. So when the water is very soft, it has a corrosive action on lead pipes. Bacteriologically, rain water is pure from where the air quality is maintained, and impurities. The rainwater tends to become impure as it passes through the atmosphere. It picks up suspended impurities from the atmosphere, such as dust, soot and microorganisms and gases such as carbon dioxide, nitrogen, oxygen and ammonia. Gaseous sulfur and nitrogen oxides are emitted from power plants that use fossil fuels. These gases react with atmosphere water, forming dilute solution of sulfuric acid, nitric acid. The precipitation of these acids, called acid rain, has begun to have serious impact on surface water quality and on plants, etc. So there are few places in the world, they mainly depend on the rainwater for their domestic and everyday uses, and one of the example is the Gibraltar. The second one is the surface water. Surface water originates from the rainwater. It is the main source of water supply in many areas. For example, surface water includes rivers, tanks, lakes, bodies, man-made reservoirs, and seawater. Surface water is prone to contamination from human and animal sources. So, as such, it is never safe for human consumption unless it is subjected to sanitary protection and purification before use. The vast majority of Indian cities and towns depend upon surface water sources, which are impounding reservoirs, rivers and streams, tanks, ponds and lakes. In general, surface water supplies poses a high probability of organic, bacterial and viral contaminations. So, the first we will have some discussion about impounding reservoirs. These are artificial lakes constructed usually of earthwork or masonry, in which large quantities of surface water is stored. Dams built across rivers and mountain stream also provide large reservoir of surface water. The area draining into the reservoir is called catchment area. Cities such as Mumbai, Chennai and Nagpur drive their water supply from impounding reservoirs. One advantage of storing water for long periods in reservoir is the growth of algae and the other microscopic organisms which impart bad taste and odors to water. So what are the characteristics of the impounding reservoir's water? Impounding reservoirs usually furnish a fairly good quality of water. The water is usually clear, palatable and ranks next to the rainwater in purity. If the surrounding hills are covered with peat, the water may acquire a brownish coloration. The water is usually soft and considered to be free of pathogenic organisms. Impurities. The upland surface water drives its impurities from the catchment area. The sources being human habitations and animal keeping or grazing. It is therefore very necessary to keep the catchment area free from human or animal intrusion. In the general belief that mountain streams are very pure water is often untrue. Even if there is no human habitation or cattle near, there is still a possibility of contamination caused by the wild animals. So, rivers. Many rivers furnish a dependable supply of water. Cities such as Delhi, Kolkata and Allahabad rely on river water for their needs. The chief drawback of river water is that it is always grossly polluted and is quite unfit for drinking without treatments. So what are the characteristics of the river water? The river water is turbid during rainy season. It may be clear in other seasons. Clarity of water is no guarantee that the river water is safe for drinking. River water contains dissolved and suspended impurities of all kinds. The bacterial count, including the human intestinal organisms, may vary high. Impurities. Rivers are described as a direct connection between the alimentary canal of the people living upstream and the mouths of those below. The impurities of the river water are derived from surface washing, sewage and sewage, water industrial and trade waste, and drainage from agriculture areas. Our custom and habits of the people, like bathing, animal washing and disposal of the dead, all add to the pollution of water. Although self-purification of certain amount does occur in river water by natural forces of purification such as dilution, sedimentation, aeration, oxidation, sunlight, plant and animal life, but these agencies are not sufficient to render the water potable. So, before drinking or for domestic purpose, it requires the purifications. So, tanks. Tanks are large excavations in which surface water is stored. They are full of silt and colloidal matter, especially immediately after the rains. The older the tank may be full of aquatic vegetations. So, the tanks are often used for washing of clothes, kettles, humans, cooking pots, children use it for swimming, and there may be a regular defecation around the edges which will be washed into the tank of the next rains. So, to use the tanks, we require some improvement. So, like certain amount of natural purification does take place in the tank water because of storage, oxidation, other agencies, but these are not sufficient to render the water safe. The sanitary quality of the tank water may be considerably improved by observing the following steps. Number one, the edges of the tank should be elevated to prevent the entry of surface washings. So the water from the surrounding areas, they should not enter inside the tank. There should be a fence around the tank to prevent access to animals. No one should be permitted to get into the tank directly. There should be an elevated platform from where people can draw water. The weeds should be periodically removed. The tank should be cleaned at the end of the dry season. Sea water. Though the source is plentiful, but it contains 3.5% of salts in solution. Offshore waters of the oceans and seas have a salt concentration up to 30,000 to 36,000 milligram per liter of dissolved solids, which includes around 19,000 mg per liter of chloride, 10,600 milligram per liter of sodium and 1,270 milligram per liter of magnesium. Desalting and demineralization process involves very heavy expenditure. Although the countries where the water, other sources of water are less, they are using the sea water. Groundwater. Rainwater percolating into the ground constitutes the groundwater. Groundwater is the cheapest and most practical means of providing water to small communities. Groundwater is superior to surface water because the ground itself provides an effective filtering medium. So the advantage of the groundwater is it is likely to be free from pathogenic agents. It is usually requires no treatment. The supply is likely to be certain even during dry season. It is less subject to contamination than surface water. And the disadvantages we have, it is high in mineral content like salts of calcium and magnesium, which render the water hard. It requires pumping of some arrangements to lift water. The usual groundwater sources are wells and springs. So wells have been classified into shallow and deep wells, the dug and tube wells. Technically, wells are of two kinds, shallow and deep. So the shallow wells tap subsoil water, the water from above the first impervious layer in the ground. Their yield is limited quantity and the water is notoriously liable to pollution unless care is taken in well construction. The deep wells. A deep well is one which taps water from the water-bearing stratum below the first impervious layer in the ground. Deep wells furnish the safe water and are often the most satisfactory sources of water supply. Most of the wells in India are of the shallow type. Speaking generally, the shallow wells are liable to pollution from neighboring sources of contaminants such as latrines, urinals, drains, cesspods, sewage pits, and collection of manure. A deep well can also become a health hazard if it is open, poorly constructed and not protected against contamination. Artesian wells are kind of deep wells in which the water rises above the level of groundwater because it is held under pressure between two impervious strata. So these type of wells are not common in India. With the wells we have another problem, that is the saline intrusion. Near the sea there is a danger of infiltration of sea water into deep wells. This gives a brackish taste of water and may make the water unfit for domestic use. So wells may also be classified according to the method of construction, like into dug wells and tube wells. The dug wells are by far the commonest type in India, and there are two types of dug wells. Number one is the unlined kaccha well, and another one is the pakka well. The kaccha well is a hole dug into the water bearing stratum. The pakka well is an open well built of bricks or stones. And in some wells we can have the step wells in kind of pakka wells, which are becoming obsolete for nowadays. The steps are constructed into these wells to enable people to descend and fetch the water for their use. But in these step wells, personal contact between the user and the water takes place. Some people may even wash their faces, hands, feet, which is common in our customs. So there are few improvements in the wells. So we have the improvement of dug wells, which the unlined kaccha wells may made sanitary by deepening the bottom and installing the hand pump with screen and filling the well with coarse sand up to the water level and with clay above that level. So we have the another type of well, that is the sanitary well, but we call it as an improved well. A sanitary well is one which is properly located, well constructed and protected against contamination with view to yield a supply of safe water. So there are few points for this sanitary well which requires. The number one is the location. The first step in well construction is the choosing of the proper site. If Bacterial contamination is to be avoided, the bell should be located not less than 15 meter from likely source of contamination. The bell should be located at a higher elevation with respect to a possible source of contamination. The distance between the bell and the house of the user should also be considered. If the bell is situated very far away, the people may not use it. Lining. The lining of the bell should be built of bricks or stones set in cement up to a depth of at least 6 meters so that water centers from the bottom and not from the sides of the bell. The lining should be carried 60 to 90 centimeters above the ground level. The third one is the parapet wall. There should be a parapet wall up to the height of at least 70 to 75 centimeters. Platform. There should be the cement concrete platform round the wall extending at least 1 meter in all direction. Drain. There should be pakka drain to carry off spilled water to a public drain or a showcase pit constructed beyond the cone of filtration. The cone of filtration is the area of the drainage of the bell. Covering. The top of the bell should be closed by a cement concrete cover because the bulk of the pollution is introduced into the bell directly through the open top. Hand pump. The bell should be equipped with a hand pump for lifting the water in a sanitary manner. And the consumer responsibility. The provision of sanitary bells does not guarantee freedom from waterborne diseases unless the consumers observe certain basic precaution at the individual and family level. The last one is the quality. The physical, chemical and bacteriological quality of the water should conform to the acceptable standards of quality of safe and wholesome waters. So we have another wells, that is the tube wells. They yield water which is bacteriologically safe and also cheap in comparison to other sources of supply. Shallow tube wells or driven wells have become the largest individual source of water supply to the rural community. The tube well consists of a pipe, usually galvanized iron, sunk into the water-bearing stratum and fitted with a strainer at the bottom and a hand pump at the top. The watertight concrete platform with a drain all round should be provided. The area within 15 meter of the tube well should be kept free from pollution with liquid and solid waste. The hand pump should be kept in good repair. The life of the tube well depends upon various features and it varies from place to place. Deep tube wells or bored wells are sunk by drilling through successive substrata of gravel or rock until a suitable supply of groundwater is located. This type of wells, although costly to construct and to operate, are in many ways the ideal supply. Their yield is normally very high and does not depend upon direct rainfall in the immediate vicinity. Springs. When groundwater comes to the surface and flows freely under natural pressure, it is called springs. Springs may be of two types, the shallow springs and the deep springs. Shallow springs dry up quickly during summer months, whereas deep springs do not show seasonal fluctuation in the flow of water. So, the water pollution. Pure uncontaminated water does not occur in nature. It contains impurities of various kinds, natural and man-made. The natural impurities are not essentially dangerous. These comprises dissolved gases like nitrogen, carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, etc., which may be picked up during rainfall, and dissolved minerals, salts of calcium, magnesium, sodium, etc., which are natural constituents of water following its contact with soil and suspended impurities. These impurities are derived from the atmosphere, catchment area, and the soil. But the more serious aspect of water pollution is the caused by human activity like urbanization and industrialization. The sources of pollution resulting from these are sewage, which contains decomposable organic matter and pathogenic agents, industrial and trade waste, which contain toxic agents ranging from metal salts to complex synthetic organic chemicals, the agriculture pollutants, which comprise fertilizers and pesticides, and the physical pollutants like heat, thermopollution and radioactive substances. The indicators of pollution include the amount of total suspended solids, biochemical oxygen demand, BOD, at 20 degrees centigrade, concentration of chlorides, nitrogen and phosphorus, and absence of dissolved oxygen. So, what are the diseases which we get from the water? The man's health may be affected by the ingestion of contaminated water, either directly or through food, and by the use of contaminated water for purpose of personal hygiene and recreation. The term water-related diseases include the classical waterborne diseases. The water-related diseases may be classified as follows. The number one is the biological, that is the waterborne diseases, and these caused by the presence of an infective agent like viral, the viral hepatitis A, hepatitis E, poliomyelitis, rotavirus, diarrhea in infants, bacterial, typhoid and paratyphoid fever, bacillary dysentery, E. coli diarrhea, cholera, etc. Protozoal, amoebiasis, giardiasis, helminthic, roundworm, threadworm, hydatid disease, leptospiral, Wills disease, and those due to the presence of an aquatic host, that are like snail, schistosomiasis, cyclops, guinea worms, fish tapeworm disease. The second is the chemical. The chemical pollutants of diverse nature derived from industrial and agriculture waste are increasingly finding their way into the public water supplies. These pollutants include detergent solvents, cyanides, heavy metals, minerals and organic acids, nitrogenous substances, bleaching agents, dyes, pigments, sulfides, ammonia, toxic and biocidal organic compounds of great variety. Chemical pollutants may affect man's health not only directly but also indirectly by accumulating in aquatic life like fishes. When we eat, we may get some diseases, and one of the examples is Minamata disease. In addition to this, we have another problems like the dental health. The presence of fluoride at about 1 milligram per liter in drinking water is known to protect against dental caries, but high levels of fluoride cause mottling of the dental enamel. Cyanosis in infant. High nitrate content of water is associated with methemoglobinemia. So this is a rare occurrence but may occur when surface water from farmland treated with fertilizers gain access to the water supply. Cardiovascular diseases. Hardness of waters appears to have a beneficial effect against cardiovascular diseases. Some diseases are transmitted because of inadequate use of water, like shigellosis, trachoma and conjunctivitis, ascaris, scabies. Some diseases are related to the disease-carrying insects like breeding in or near water, like malaria, filaria, arboviruses, onchocerciasis, African trypanosomiasis. While pollution seems to be an inevitable consequence of modern industrialized technology, the problem now is to determine the level of pollution that permits economic and social development without presenting hazards to health. So the water pollution law was passed by the Indian Parliament in 1974, which provides constitution of the central and state water bodies and joint water boards, which they endowed with wide powers for controlling the water pollution. Thank you.